I wonder if you've ever noticed there is something a bit peculiar about the personal histories of the very first disciples of Jesus Christ. If you study the New Testament with some care, you can rather easily see that their human stories can be divided into two rather distinct phases. In phase one, they first encountered Jesus. They are certainly challenged by his teaching, intrigued by his personality, and simply amazed by his miracles. Then they begin to take the very first and sometimes hesitant steps of discipleship. Some of them even radically change their lives for his sake. They leave home. They give up their own jobs. They become his disciples, which means students of Jesus, whom they recognize as their teacher. They follow Jesus, and they become a community gathered together under his authority. They listen to his words, but it is also quite clear from the text of all four Gospels that they do not understand much of what Jesus is saying. They also remain rather weak men, even petty, sometimes sinful, often contentious. In other words, they're rather like all of us. And when Jesus was arrested, they all fled in terror in the face of the catastrophe of the cross. They trembled behind locked doors and closed windows, with their minds almost as locked and closed as those doors and windows. They had never fully understood Jesus, who Jesus really was, and what Jesus really was all about. Now, after Good Friday, they were really ready, perhaps even a little eager, to simply go back to their old lives and return with some relief to their former jobs and their past comfortable ways of thinking and living. So what in the world was it that so dramatically transformed these once frightened, timid men, just as weak and human as we are, into bold and courageous apostles? What inspired these Galilean countrymen who had hardly seen a city except for Jerusalem during the festivals to eventually travel to the very ends of the earth to announce the good news and even to face terrible persecution, even martyrdom, out of love for Jesus Christ? What happened to those first disciples that carried them from timidity into fearless conviction? Well, what happened, first of all, was that 3 days after the Lord's death and burial, beyond all hope or any expectation, the disciples personally encountered the risen Christ. They saw Jesus, who truly died on the cross, but now was truly risen from the dead. This was no ghost or merely a mystical vision. These hard-headed fishermen actually heard him speak. They saw his wounds. They touched him. They even ate and drank with him. Now, with absolute conviction, they can call him my Lord and my God. But there was still a second life-changing experience that would guide their journey of conversion and affect their complete transformation. Remember that before Jesus suffered and died, he told his disciples that he had much more to teach them. not yet able to bear it. So he promised to send another advocate, the very Spirit of truth, the Holy Paraclete, who would teach them all things. After he ascended to the right hand of the Father, Jesus fulfilled that promise. 2,000 years ago, on this very evening, on the vigil of Pentecost, the apostles gathered together with Blessed Mary and watched and prayed for that outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Early the next morning, the house suddenly began to shake as if from an earthquake or a mighty wind. And then tongues of fire came down upon them, hovering over their heads. The very Spirit of God that forever unites the love of the Father to the love of His Son, that Creator Spirit, the Lord and Giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, the third person of the Most Blessed Trinity, who with the Father and the Son is ever to be worshipped and adored, that same Spirit overshadowed them and filled them, transformed them, and empowered them. They began to throw open the windows and the doors, and like folks on fire, they began to announce the gospel and preach the resurrection. The crowds gathered together for the festival thought they may have been drunk on new wine. Well, in a certain sense, they were drunk, but drunk with the new wine of the kingdom, intoxicated by the gifts of the Spirit, inebriated by the personal experience of the Spirit. On Pentecost Sunday, the Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church was born, overflowing with wisdom and counsel, fortitude and knowledge, piety and reverence, and awe before the glory of the Lord. Fearful disciples became bold apostles, born again through water and the Holy Spirit. They no longer owned their own lives. God owned and possessed them. From now on, their time and talent belonged to the Lord and would be used for His kingdom. Pentecost and all the transforming power of the Holy Spirit had changed everything about them. They became a new people, a royal priesthood, God's holy nation, a people set apart. My spiritual sons and daughters, my fellow Catholics, my dear friends in Christ, I am more and more convinced that today the Diocese of Peoria needs a spiritual conversion and a more profound renewal of all the transforming gifts of the Holy Spirit. How can we rest when so many still do not know the Lord? How can we be passive when even many Catholics have fallen away from the true faith? How can we be inactive when so many are hungry and naked, homeless and poor, sick and burdened by addictions or illness? Are we weary of generosity or tired of service? Why do we allow our judges and politicians to continue to persecute God's holy church while they exempt themselves from the crimes of the state and of their own institutions? Why do we fail to stand up and defend our faith when the right to life, when God's plan for human sexuality, when the holiest things of our holy religion are grossly and relentlessly mocked by Hollywood on television and in the media? Now the Catholics are somewhat richer, and at least some are welcome in the country club. Have we lost our voices or our capacity for righteous anger? Why are we so passive? Why do we we want to really live our precious faith, we too must all seek a richer encounter with the risen Christ and more fully embrace the power of His Spirit. And then with absolute assurance, live in the conviction that Jesus is Lord. The awesome truth should entirely change us, and that is because Christ is risen. Christ is risen, and sin and death have been overturned. Christ is risen, and sentence has been passed on the world, the flesh, and the devil. Christ is risen, and in the power of the resurrection, we can begin to taste the grace and glory of heaven, even here on earth. The resurrection, the ascension, and Pentecost all manifest the saving acts of Almighty God, given to entirely win our hearts and change our lives. But for this deep conversion to continue, we will also need to beg from God those Pentecost gifts. Filled with the Holy Spirit, our minds would be illuminated and our hearts enkindled, and our strength and energy would be unleashed for the glory of God and the service of neighbor. We would know amazing grace and a comfort and peace and a joy beyond all telling. Baptism, confirmation, and Eucharist certainly make happen what they signify, but the effects of these great sacraments depend upon our personal faith and our cooperation with God's grace. The literal meaning of the word liturgy is the work of the people. After the liturgies of our worship, there must therefore be a renewed liturgy of our lives, and the work of the Christian people is to go out into the whole world and make disciples. So what would happen if I missed the vigil of Pentecost in the year of our Lord, 2017, if starting with me, your unworthy servant, and with all of you who are the teachers, the catechists, the parish ministers, here assembled in prayerful company with St. Mary in her cathedral, just as the disciples of old were once gathered with Mary in the upper room, what would happen if we all prayed together for a new Pentecost? I can promise you what would happen would be wondrous, miraculous, and tremendous. More than buildings would shake, the whole world could be shaken down to its foundation. Sinners would be converted, devils cast out, the sick healed, the poor fed and comforted, enemies reconciled, and through the Holy Spirit, worship, praise, and thanks would be ceaselessly offered up before the throne of Almighty God. Remember the invincible power of the Spirit and all the great works of the Spirit. Remember it was the Holy Spirit who hovered over the primordial waters when the world evolved from chaos. Remember it was the Holy Spirit who guided the patriarchs, filled judges and kings with strength, and inspired the prophets, poets, and sages. Remember, it was the Holy Spirit who, in the fullness of time, overshadowed Mary when the Word became flesh. Remember, it was the Holy Spirit who came down upon Jesus at the River Jordan when the voice of God declared, "This is my beloved Son. Hear him." Remember, it was the Holy Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead. So in this, at the conclusion of this year's Summer Institute, let us fervently pray together for a second step in our own continuing conversion. Let us all beg for a deeper and more powerful experience of the Spirit of God, and for a new evangelization and a new by the Spirit's gifts. We can then count bread, our families, our neighbors, the state of Illinois, the United States of America, the Western Hemisphere, and even the whole world to faith in Jesus Christ. We would be a church on fire for our glorious and risen Lord. So, on this vigil of Pentecost, let us pray intently. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill the hearts of the faithful. Enkindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Holy Spirit, and we shall be recreated, and you shall renew us.